Hello, my landing crew people. Today's video is all about ADHD signs in older kids. I don't really have an exact age group, but I would say probably like 6 or older. If you have a younger child you're kind of wondering about, I've done a younger video. Today's gonna be all about an older child, probably in school. They might have not been super hyperactive, and so maybe they kind of got missed on the earlier signs. If you don't know me, my name is Stephanie. I have ADHD, my husband has ADHD, and 4 of our 6 kids have ADHD as well. My 15-year-old Danielle, there wasn't anything that really struck me as, oh yeah, she has ADHD. She was a little bit hyper, but nothing abnormal, and then once she got in school, we realized that there was a problem. Reading took forever with Danielle, and I just thought that was normal. She was my first one, so I thought, well, maybe it's just taking longer for 5-year-olds to pick up on it. As time went on, as school years went on, we realized that it was something different. From 2nd to 6th grade, she was on medication. If you want to know more about Danielle's story, how she manages it without medication because she's in 10th grade this year, then I will leave her video in the links below and you can check that out for yourself. This video is going to be just more about the signs that you can look for, and also at the end I will be answering questions and answers.
Answering questions, that's what Q&A is.
Let's get started. Now, I give this disclaimer every single video that I do signs of anything. Just because your child has 1 or 2 of these things doesn't mean they have ADHD. But just because they don't have all of this doesn't mean they do not. If you're concerned about your kid, speak to their physician and or their teacher. So, the first sign is self-focused behavior. If your child is like, me, 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 me. A prominent sign in ADHD in older children is the inability to kind of recognize others' needs and that there's others in the world besides them. This can be shown by maybe interrupting. They talk over a lot. I have the worst problem about talking over people, but it's hard for them to like take their turn in conversation and then just in playing. They aren't purposely trying to be selfish or self-absorbed. It's just beyond their control to realize that, hey, there's other people around me. Now, that isn't to say that isn't something that they can't learn. I know that Danielle has learned that, and I'm still working on that on myself. Another one is maybe they are butting into conversations that's not theirs. Hearing everything, I guess. I think that's kind of common. Like, it's like everything is everywhere. I didn't know this was a sign of ADHD, but Lonnie Jr. does that a lot. Another sign, if they have problems regulating their emotions. So maybe something small makes them really mad, or something small makes them cry at everything. I think that's one thing that you're going to realize the most, especially on boys. Not saying it can't happen in girls. I think girls like probably cry easier. I'd cry over everything when I was a kid, sometimes as an adult, but shh, don't tell anyone. And I don't really know the reason behind this. I don't know if maybe our minds and brains are moving so fast and our thoughts are moving so fast that it's hard to realize, oh, we need to not interrupt this person, or oh, we need to calm down before we react kind of thing. I just know it's very, very common. So if you have a child that's really struggling emotionally, whether it's anger, sadness, a lot of crying, a lot of outbursts, then that can definitely be a sign that something else is going on. And not necessarily ADHD. A lot of signs in ADHD overlap with a million other things. So that's why I'm saying if you have a concern, definitely talk to their doctor. Another sign could be fidgeting. They always have to kind of play with something. I am a fidgeter when I am doing anything and everything. It's why when I'm on video, I have to like talk with my hands. I hate it. It's distracting sometimes, but I'm a really good multitasker that way. I can do a lot of different things at once, but if you just ask me to do one activity, I can't. So if they're constantly just having to play with something, maybe it's their hair, they might be like squirmy, just can't sit still in their seat, always getting up, always going around. I think fidgeting and not being able to stay in their seat is probably one of the signs that the teachers notice first, because if you have a classroom of students that they're all sitting calmly, and then suddenly you have one that's just like getting up and going everywhere, that can definitely be an issue. Because fidgetiness can become a problem, this leads us to our next sign of inability or problems playing quietly. All of my ADHD kids are always the type that if they're doing something, they're making some type of noise with it. I know Lex, he just constantly makes noises with his mouth. It's harder for them to just kind of chill out and be chill. The next sign would be unfinished tasks. If this can be unfinished homework, unfinished chores, unfinished projects. It's hard for them to stay on one task to finish. All of my kids, I have to keep at them. I can't tell you how many chores that they start and they have to restart it like literally 10 times, but I'm used to it. So I'm okay with constantly going behind them because the more you do it, the more it helps them kind of stay on task. I will ask them, what are you doing right now? It makes them stop and think, okay, what am I supposed to be doing kind of thing. So unfinished tasks is a really common thing. We lose focus and we get distracted really easily. Distractibility is a really, really big thing. The next sign would be lack of focus. They may have trouble paying attention when you're talking to them, you know, their mind just trails off. It's hard to focus. And it's not that they're trying to be rude or they don't care. There are times people are talking to me and I'm looking at them. I hear the words. I physically hear them, but I can't tell you what you just said. This one kind of goes into unfinished tasks and not being able to pay attention, but if they constantly avoid a task. So if I ask the kids to do something that they necessarily know is going to take more mental effort, they're like, okay, I'll do it in like 45 minutes. And then the 45 minutes comes and then they never do it. So we've learned that when we want something done, when we ask them to do something, that we have them do it right then. Because if not, it just won't get done. And then it's frustrating to us. Like even having ADHD and struggling, Lonnie and I are very understanding, but we have a household to run. They have chores to do. They have homework. They have things that have to be done. So we have to stay on focus. When we were homeschooling them, they knew the first thing they had to do was their schoolwork. If you guys want me to do a video of tips of having an ADHD child, things that have kind of helped us along the way, I'd be more than happy to do that. I don't feel like ADHD is talked about a lot. I feel like it's overlooked as just kind of like whatever. I've lived with it my entire life. I don't think it's a big deal, but it does take some special curving and effort and things like that. The next sign would be mistakes because they have trouble focusing, following through, paying attention. I mean, of course, there's going to be lots of mistakes, and it's usually simple, silly mistakes. I had to tell my kiddos a lot, slow down, focus on what you're doing, and go from there. A lot of people think, okay, they're just making this mistake because they're lazy, or they don't want to do it, or they're being stubborn, or they just don't care, and that's not the case. They simply just overlook it, they forget, it slips their mind. A lot of these things are beyond their control. But when I say it's beyond their control, that doesn't mean that they can't learn to make it under their control and learn how to function with having ADHD. Sometimes with ADHD, we think of loud and just crazy rambunctious kids, kind of like our landing crew kids. But no, sometimes they can just be very daydreamy. Lonnie Jr. is probably more daydreamy than anyone else. Like this next one isn't going to come as a surprise, but trouble being organized. I know that Danielle's backpack, her desk always looks like a hot mess. Her room always looks like a hot mess. It's never organized. There's a difference between not being organized and just being like gross and messy. It's just hard to stay organized, get organized, and stay on top of it. Like I want to use a planner, but I just can't. As Danielle's gone older, she's had to be intentional with it. She's had to be like, okay, it's time to clean out my backpack. But if they're having a really hard time with that and they're displaying other signs as well, that can definitely indicate that something else is going on. And this is why it's really uncommon for a child under the age of 5 to be diagnosed with ADHD. These signs really don't show up until their school age, until the social and academic and responsibility demands are a lot higher. Another sign is, of course, forgetfulness. I think it all goes hand in hand. Like if you aren't actively being able to concentrate, focus, pay attention, these signs you're probably going to see everywhere you go. And it's going to look different in every child. If they go to school, they're going to show these signs. At home, they're going to show these signs. I can give examples of every one of my children in the school setting and also at the home setting as well. So if your child is just showing issues at home or they're just showing issues at school, that's not to say they don't have ADHD, but it may be harder to distinguish that. This is kind of like a big range because of course we're talking 6+ and then the next video is going to be adult. So this is also going to be as they get into teen years. And you're going to notice as your child gets older and gets into those preteen and teen years that they're probably not going to have as much self-control as other kids their age. Individuals with ADHD are very impulsive. I have a lot of impulsive ideas, but before I take action, I think about it over and over and over again to almost almost to an obsessive point because I'm so afraid of making the wrong impulsive action or decision or choice. So some of the things that your child may struggle with as they're getting into those preteen and teen years is turning in school assignments, staying up with school assignments, reading social cues, compromising appropriately with peers, maintaining their personal hygiene. Maybe they don't like taking care of themselves very well. Helping out with chores at home, time management, driving safely. Is that why I'm such a bad driver? If they don't seem to listen, which we kind of covered, but that's like a big one, I feel like. I think everyone knows their child. Like Danielle was never a child that would intentionally disobey. She was always a really good kid, but she was very forgetful. You know, it seemed like she didn't listen ever. Like, I'm like, did you hear me? I talked about distractibility, but another one is that they talk excessively.
If you know anyone that does that, let me know.
I kind of also want to talk about, like, at what point do you consider medication or not medication? I didn't really talk too much in detail on this, on the younger signs. Every parent is going to have a different answer for every child. Out of my 4 kids that have ADHD, only one has been medicated with ADHD meds. Noah, my 12-year-old, was, but he also has autism, and the med he was on was more just to help with the hyperactivity, which can come along with autism as well. But Danielle, my 15-year-old, she was on meds. And for us, it was because it was affecting her schoolwork. It was affecting her grades significantly. So for her, it was crucial for her to get on meds. My 14-year-old, Lonnie Jr., he was just really, really hyper. He wouldn't calm down. The teachers wanted me to medicate him, but I refused to. I was like, I'm not gonna just medicate him to make your job easier, kind of thing. Again, every parent has a different point on what they think it's appropriate or not. But we've always used the stance with our kids, are we medicating them to make their lives easier or our lives easier? And if the answer is not their lives easier, then we do not do it. Lonnie Jr. had great grades. There was nothing going on. I mean, he came home. We didn't really have many issues with him. So there wasn't anything that I felt was appropriate to medicate for. Danielle was failing. She was significantly behind. Noah's hyperactivity was to a point that he was not able to function correctly. He wasn't sleeping. Lux is only 4, so I don't know if we'll end up medicating for him, but when you have a child that has a lot of hyperactivity, a lot of just impulsivity, it's hard for them to calm down. I think it's really important for them to still learn those coping skills. For Noah, he had to calm down first to learn those skills. So sometimes medication just helps long enough to calm them down, to help them learn those coping skills. So now Noah doesn't take any medication for his ADHD. He takes clonidine at night to help sleep, and then he takes lithium for his aggression and irritability and things like that. But other than that, he's doing great. Don't let anyone make you feel bad for medicating or feel bad for not medicating. Diet changes can also help a lot. All right, so it's time to get on to the questions and answers. This question kind of goes into me talking about medication, so it's an appropriate first question. Ashley O asks, how did you decide what child needed meds and who could live without them? Where do you draw the line between the meds benefiting them and being a detriment? Danielle's the only one that I can really answer this on, because the meds Noah was on for ADHD, they were mainly meds that were used for blood pressure, so it just like calmed him down. For us to put her on the meds, it was because she was failing, obviously. So at this point, we knew something had to give. She was struggling so much, and we could tell it was beyond her control. When we decided to take her off of it, we had a couple trial periods of, okay, is this working? Is this not working, kind of thing. I think we tried taking her off meds 4 or 5 times, just because the meds have some pretty bad side effects, which I know you're aware of, Ash, but it wasn't to a point where I was okay with her staying off of them until she was off of them and her grades weren't significantly suffering. Now, when she did go off of them the last time, her grades did take a little bit of a dive, but she had to learn how to be able to keep those up. I think she's at an age where I'm okay with her deciding to be on meds or not be on meds. Like if she told me, hey, I wanna go back on medication, I would be like, okay. But I think at some point, the child does get to have some say in their treatment plan. This is something Danielle will live with the rest of her life. This is something you'll live with for the rest of your life. So I think it's important to have some say. So the next question is from Emily Nichols, and she asked, what benefits are offered if formally diagnosed? I have ADHD. I suspect my daughter does as well. but here it would be a two-year battle to get a diagnosis, and we would not medicate her. Personal choice. We don't feel she needs it. So, Emily, we never got Lonnie Jr. formally diagnosed. I think the only time a diagnosis would benefit is if you're going to get your child on medication, or it's important for the school to know that. I do think it's good for them to be aware of it. I think it helps us understand ourselves, which I'm sure you know. Sometimes I get mad at my ADHD because it does sometimes keep me from doing things that other people do with no problem. So I think understanding that and understanding how it affects us is important. It's like any other label, but if you're not going to medicate your child and they're not significantly suffering in school or anything like that, then I don't think it's a big deal. And honestly, even a formal ADHD diagnosis really doesn't help you in the school setting that much. Morgan asked two questions. She asked, what's the steps into getting a five-year-old tested for ADHD? Anytime you have a concern about your child, whether it's ADHD, intellectual disability, autism, anything like that, you always just go to your doctor first. Sometimes the pediatrician can do the evaluation, and sometimes they have to refer you to someone else. Now, the other question she asks is, how do you keep control the ADHD and help them focus on a task? A lot of reminders. Like when I'm supposed to be editing, I stop a lot and I want to do other stuff just because staying on one task is hard for me. So a lot of times I have to just disable the Wi-Fi, just be like, Stephanie, keep going, keep going, keep going. So it's a lot of just repetition and getting them into a good routine of it. Rose's nephew asked, what is the difference between ADHD, ADD, and autism? ADD is no longer a term from what I understand. It's only ADHD now. The traits of ADHD and autism overlap a lot, so it's easy to get it confused, especially in the younger years. But as they get older, it becomes kind of obvious. When Noah was younger, it all looked the same, but now that he's older, I can pinpoint, okay, that's autistic traits or that's ADHD traits. But the biggest ones are probably social and communication. I talked about this more in the younger ADHD signs video, so I'll link that one as well if you want to go watch that. Tara McCabe asks, based on your experience, do you think ADHD could likely go undiagnosed in teens if they didn't show extreme signs as a young child? Yes. ADHD is like a spectrum. It is not autism. It is completely separate. It is not the same. I got some of those comments on my last ADHD video. Autism and ADHD are not the same. They are different diagnoses for different reasons. But it is a spectrum in itself. You can be severely affected by ADHD or you can be mildly affected by it. John Tyler asked, did Noah's ADHD affect his school life? I love your videos. Thank you, John. And yes, it definitely did, because he was unable to react appropriately to different emotions, his hyperactivity, his inability to concentrate. All of those just are a recipe for disaster. When you add in some autistic traits too, it can definitely make learning a struggle. We have to give Noah a lot of breaks with school, or we used to. He's usually pretty good about it now. He just wants to get it all done. But when we first started homeschooling him, I had to give him constant breaks. Like sometimes we would have to have a break halfway through math. Anna asked a very good question. Anna, this is awesome. Anna said, my biggest question is how to deal with judgment that your child's ADHD is caused by poor parenting. And how can we change that stigma? There's nothing wrong with having ADHD. It's just what we have. It's part of who we are. And there's a label attached to it so we can understand ourselves better and so others can too. So I think talking about it more, I think some people are going to just assume it's poor parenting. I think if someone's really going to take your child's diagnosis and try pinning it on you as a parent, I don't think there's anything that you're going to say to change their mind. Mariana said, hello, I'm a teacher. I'm currently in a class of six-year-old kids. God bless you, girl. I'm struggling a lot with a couple of kids with ADHD. What can I do to make things better in the classroom? I just think patience. Patience is so important with ADHD.
So important.
Visual reminders, lots of reminders, just getting in a habit of keeping them focused. Again, stopping them and asking them, what are you doing right now? Don't tell them what they're supposed to be doing. Don't say, why aren't you doing handwriting? What are you doing right now? If they're always like up and about and walking around the classroom and they can't sit in their seat, which is common with six-year-old, especially with ADHD, giving them something that they can hold and fidget with. Jessica Johnston also asked a great question. How can ADHD look with kids who have ASD? So a child that's ADHD and autistic. Like, how does that look? I feel like a lot of times it's the kids that are overlooked. For Lex, it's extreme hyperactivity, extreme impulsivity. It seems like their struggles are more and more heightened because they have both of those things going on. That is it, guys. That is all of the questions. This video is going up while we are in Colorado. So if you're wanting to follow our Colorado trip, definitely follow us at Arlene and Creator Instagram. We will be posting tons of pictures, tons of stories to share with all of you. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Where you move, make me blind. You will always be there. There's no doubt in my mind. You will always be there. Heading out to see ya and leave the rest behind. Oh, oh, oh. 'Cause you will always be there.